Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking about cash and receivables, what they are, why they're important, how we can help control cash with some financial accounting techniques, and then how we account for receivables. We've done accounts receivable issuances, note receivable issuances, how we account for the repayments, how we can use our receivables as collateral in loans. And now we get to talk about one last topic with receivables, and that is how we can dispose of them rather than wait for them to be collected. You see, a lot of companies don't really want to wait and collect their accounts receivable. Some companies take advantage of the collateral option, where at least they get the cash up front, but others don't want to collect at all. So they sell or factor their accounts receivable to other entities. Now, this is really very common. We actually see it all the time. You probably have done this in just the last few days if you use a credit card. You see, our credit card is the perfect form of factoring. We go in, we buy something at Walmart or Shopko or whatever store we go into, and instead of giving them money, we swipe our card. When we swipe our card, the store gets their money immediately by selling that sale or that receivable to the bank. So instead of Macy's or Walmart or whoever having to collect the money from us, Visa or MasterCard or Discover or whoever it is, they collect the money from us. That's factoring. Walmart doesn't have to worry about it. The bank worries about it, or the Visa worries about it, etc. That's what we're talking about here. And again, it's become very common. It's so common that how we do this is another one of our key concepts for this chapter, because it's just part of everyday transactions now. The good thing about factoring is that it gives the company all or most of the cash up front. They don't quite get all of it, because most buyers or factors have some kind of a discount that they charge companies for the service that they're providing. I tell you, I've got $100 worth of receivables. You look at that and say, yeah, I can probably collect 75 of that really easy, but there's some risk. I won't get the other 25. I'll buy it from you, but for 95 bucks. I'm not paying you the full 100, because I probably won't get the full 100. That's what we're talking about with these discounts. Now, you've probably dealt with this if you've ever whipped out a credit card and had a company say, you know, we don't take American Express or Discover, or, you know, we don't take credit cards, it's cash or check only. Those are companies that have said, you know, that factoring fee is so big for those particular cards or for cards in general, we're not going to do it. We need more money, so we'll collect ourselves. And that's what dissuades companies from factoring, is this charge. When you do decide to factor, you can factor in one of two ways. You can do it with recourse or without recourse. Without recourse, we'll talk about it first because it's the most common. This is what most credit cards are. The buyer assumes all of the risks associated with the accounts receivable that they've purchased. So as a seller, I'm walking away. I don't care anymore about these receivables. They're your problem. You bought them and you have to deal with it. So if people default, not my problem, your problem. That's without recourse. The factor can't come back to the seller and say, hey, all these people defaulted. Not my problem. Contractually, it's your issue now. You thought you could collect it all. Although they can't come back to the seller for defaults, they can come back to the seller for refunds when items are returned, or for the cash discounts that we allowed in our contract. So if we factor a bunch of receivables with the whole 210 net 30 thing, and people pay on day 9, the factor is not going to eat that 2%. You issued the contract as the original seller. You have to deal with it. So what the bank or the Visa company or whoever it is, what they'll normally do, these factors, is they'll say, look, we're going to buy all of your accounts receivable, but there's a portion of them that could get a discount or could be returned. So we're going to hold back some of that money. And once the discount or the return period has ended, then if there's anything left, if we haven't had to use this money to cover these discounts or returns, we'll send you a check for the rest of it. But we're not going to eat these discounts or these returns. They're your problem. So the factor creates a due to account. It's due to the seller of these accounts receivables. And the seller records a little mini account receivable. They get rid of most of their receivables. They create this little mini receivable called due from factor. Meaning, I'm going to get this money back, I hope, because my customers won't take discounts or they won't return items, and I'll get my money back from the factor. Usually it's a set percentage or a set amount. It's in the contract. It's really pretty easy to keep track of from an accounting perspective, but it's something that we have to watch because we don't want them to hold on to too much of our money, but we have to let them hold on to some of it. And again, the idea here is the bank doesn't want to have to come back after us. They're just going to keep the money themselves, and they'll send us the leftovers later. The other option here is with recourse, meaning that the seller keeps all of the risks of default. Basically, if you were to factor to me, so you've sold me all of your accounts receivables, I would say, you know what? I'm probably better at collections than you are. I've got bigger guys, I've got brass knuckles, and I could probably get more of that money than you could, but I'm not going to be on the hook for the people who don't pay. You're going to keep that risk. And if they don't pay, I'm going to come after you, and you're going to have to send me a check for that difference. So the seller has to pay any difference that occurs between what they said people were going to, what people said they were going to pay and what they didn't pay. In order to account for this risk as a seller, you would have to record what's called a recourse liability. You're going to get rid of your allowance for bad debt. We'll always get rid of that, whether it's with recourse or without. But if it's with recourse, because you now have this obligation to pay me, the factor, if your customers default, you're going to create this recourse liability account. It's your best guess at what I, as the factor, will not be able to collect. Now, a lot of people at this point say, well, great, I'll just take my allowance for bad debt and I'll stick it in as a liability and call it good. No. Allowance for bad debt is based on what you thought you couldn't collect. Factors are much better at it. They do this for a living, right? If I'm a store and I sell to people on account, I'm not a collection agency. I'm not good at this stuff. So I may only be able to collect 90%. I sell to my factor. Factor does this all the time. He's got, he knows all the tricks, all the techniques, much better at it, can concentrate his energy on making collections. Like I said, bigger guys with brass knuckles, etc. So while you may only be able to collect 90%, I may be able to collect 95%. So when I get rid of my allowance, I'm just going to close out the allowance. And I'm going to create this new recourse liability based on what the factor won't be able to collect. The last thing here, just like without recourse, we still have a due to and due from account. Remember, we keep track of these cash discounts and the returns. They're separate from the ability of the factor to collect the receivables. So with or without recourse doesn't really matter. There's still going to be this due from account unless you factor after the discount period has ended and the returns period is over. If that's the case, then they don't need a due to or due from account. So let's take a look at an example. This is SOS company. They need cash. Get it? SOS. They. Well, I thought it was funny. Anyway, SOS company needs cash right away, so they've decided to factor their accounts receivable. Then they don't have to worry about the collections. They currently have $750,000 worth of receivables. Of that, they figure that 1% will still qualify for a discount. 2.5% will probably be returned just based on their previous experience. They estimate that $35,000 of the accounts receivable is uncollectible to the factors. And right now, they have $30,000 in their allowance for bad debt. So they're actually factoring and think that the factors will have a harder time collecting than they did, which is weird. Usually it goes the other way, but hey, it happens, especially if these are more delinquent accounts. It could also be that I let my allowance for bad debt get kind of low, and one of the reasons I'm factoring now is so that I don't have a big expense later as I get ripped off by a lot of people. So that's what those numbers mean. Firm X then has decided or offered to buy the accounts receivable without recourse. Financing charge will be 6%. We want to do the journal entries for both companies for this potential transaction. Now, let me just tell you, the secret to factoring and doing it well and easily is to always do the factors entry first. Why? Because with recourse, without recourse, doesn't matter. The factors entry is always the same. So just get in the habit, do the factors entry first and then do the sellers. So let's start with factor X here. Factor X is getting accounts receivable of $750,000. They're charging a 6% finance charge. So $750,000 times 6% is $45,000. So that's their finance revenue, is $45,000. They also think of the $750,000 that 1% and 2.5% will never be collected because of discounts, that's the one, and returns, the 2.5. So that 3.5% comes out to $26,250. And they're gonna call that a due 2SOS 26250. Now, just really quick on this. Here's the money that we think we're going to get from the factor, right? Some of this goes to fees, so I'm not going to get that amount of cash. Some of it is the 1% and the 2.5%, and I'm not going to get that either. This is just in case people don't have to pay because of the cash discount or don't have to pay because of the returns policy. So they're only going to give us the difference. They're carving out the fees and they're carving out this 1% and 2.5%, and we're only going to get the difference. Later on, if people don't get the discounts or they don't get or don't make any returns, then we'll get this portion back. The difference, we carve out the fees, we carve out the just-in-case stuff for the returns and discounts, that's the amount they're actually going to pay to SOS Company. So $678,750. And this is purchased accounts receivable from SOS, 6% finance charge, 3.5% saved for discounts and returns. Now again, once I have these numbers, it's really easy to transfer them over to SOS. So I know now I'm getting cash of $678,750. I know my accounts receivable is going away. I know I've got a due from factor X of $26,250. And now I just have two more accounts. One is an allowance for bad debt. I'm going to get rid of the $30,000 that I have in my allowance account. I wish I were done at that point. It would be great if I were, but I'm not. This doesn't balance. It doesn't balance. So take a look at that. Do you need a debit or a credit to make this balance? You need a debit. Specifically, you need $15,000 to make this balance. Well, normally we would call that a finance charge, except it's not really a finance charge. We're selling off an asset that we don't normally sell. And if you remember, we don't call those expenses or charges. When we sell something we don't normally sell, it's either a gain or a loss. Those abnormal things are gains or losses. So this is actually, let's see, a debit would be what, a gain or a loss? It'd be a loss. So this is a loss on factoring. So I can't just call it a finance charge or an interest expense. I have to show that this is a loss because I'm selling something I don't normally sell. This is to sell accounts receivable to factor X, and then I would provide all those other details about what was being held, etc. So that's without recourse. I don't have a recourse liability, I just show this $15,000 loss, and that's it. Now let's take a look at another option. What if instead we decide to go with firm Y, and firm Y has offered to buy with recourse? So this is the opposite. We now have to record this possibility that SOS is on the hook for this extra money when people default. This is factor Y, and again, we always start with the factor's journal entry. So again, accounts receivable, that factor Y is getting is $750,000. The due to SOS will stay the same. It's still that 3.5%. And there's still a finance revenue, but this time it's a little bit different. So $750,000, if we go back, the finance charge is only 2%, and it's usually smaller with recourse because they're not taking on as much risk. So let's see, that's $15,000. So finance revenue will be $15,000, and the difference goes to cash. So $708,750 purchased accounts receivable from SOS with recourse. And then I'd add in all those other details as well. Now let's look at SOS company. And again, we're just going to take this information. So cash coming in, whoops, let me underline that. 708,750. I've got a due from factor Y, 26,250. I'm still going to get rid of my allowance for bad debt, still $30,000. And I'm going to leave a space. I don't know if I'm going to have a gain or a loss, so let's leave a space so that we can do it later. I know we've got accounts receivable going away for $750. And this time, I have to record a recourse liability for the amount I think I'm going to have to pay, or SOS thinks SOS is going to have to pay, to the factor. And if we remember the information, it was $35,000 right here. That's the $35,000 they think is not collectible by factor Y. So now I check again. I look through it. Do I need a debit or a credit to balance? Again, I need a debit, so I've got a loss on factoring, $20,000. Now, if SOS thought they weren't going to be able to collect $70,000, and now the recourse liability is only going to be $35,000, I might have a gain here, because there's a ton of it I can't collect, but I think they can. So I might actually be better off than this if I'm really bad at collections. Sale of accounts receivable to factor Y. And I put in all that other information there as well. We've gone a little long here again. All these examples, they'll kind of need to go together. And, you know, once you start doing journal entries, it's just so hard to stop. You just got to keep going. They're too fun to end. Let me take just a second, though, and talk about IFRS for the disposal of receivables. Under U.S. GAAP, receivables are only sold if they're legally isolated from the seller and its creditors. The buyer has the right to sell or pledge the receivables. The seller doesn't have effective control through a repurchase option, meaning I'm going to sell them to you now, and in 2 months, if you haven't collected them, I'll buy them back. Under U.S. GAAP, all of those conditions have to be met in order for it to be considered a sale. Under IFRS, receivables are sold if only one of two conditions are met. Option one, the rights to the cash flows, risks, and rewards are all transferred to the buyer, or, again, it's either or, control is transferred even though the risks and the rewards aren't transferred. Now, if you think about that, it means that if I give them the accounts receivable and they can collect them and I don't have them anymore, that's a sale. But if they assume the risk and they get the benefits when those accounts receivable are collected, then that's a sale too. Well, if you think about that, that means that under certain conditions, secured borrowing could actually be considered a sale under IFRS. Not common, but it could be with these definitions. Kind of interesting that that's the way IFRS has set it up. We've talked about a lot of cool stuff, but we need to take a bit of a break. When we come back, we'll talk about the last few issues about receivables. I'll see you then.